here, all the way from Brazil, the phenom, Vitor Belfort! Hello, guys. Are you guys ready? Everybody ready for tomorrow? Yeah, good. It's good to see all you guys happy, and you guys had a good Christmas? You guys receive a lot of presents?
Yeah, that's you guys awesome. Have any presents for Vitor?
You guys are my present. Take them. You guys are my present.
All right, let's ask your questions. Please go ahead for Vitor, right here, or myself, whatever you want, but this is Vitor's stage right now.
Bruce.
Okay.
I know you have some movie history. What was it like to introduce Antonio Banderas and play it to the bone?
Oh, that was so much fun. So much fun. As a matter of fact, when we were filming that day, I forget the referee's name, Joe Cortez from boxing. You remember Joe Cortez? So we're doing the scene, and they have the man who was co-starring on that movie playing the fight promoter. I forget his name. He's had some drug issues and stuff like that. He's made a lot of movies. So Joe's flubbed his line, right? And this guy yells as he's sitting right about third row, "Why don't you get a real actor?" Right? You never saw Joe Cortez ready to beat the heck out of somebody faster than that. I had to hold him back. He was going to go down and punch him out. He was very insulted because Joe's a very proud man. We had a lot of fun on that set, and it was a fun movie.
And blondes or brunettes?
I'm an equal opportunity lover as long as they have beautiful hair.
Thanks, Bruce.
Okay. My name is Neil Sharpads. I was going to ask you a 360 question, but I guess that's kind of been overplayed. I was going to ask you about your favorite a catchweight fight and who you would want to see in a catchweight fight. Answer between both of you.
Who would you like to fight in a special catchweight fight?
I did a lot of good fights in catchweight already. I did a catchweight.
He already did a catchweight fight.
This is like other fighters, like your, you know, dream matchups, catchweight fights. Lyoto and BJ Penn.
It's a tough question. You have so much talent and so much great fighters.
Yeah.
It's even not fair to just set one. You know, I will set a whole card.
Let me ask you a question. Who would you like to see?
I like that Lyoto Machida and BJ Penn fight, but I'd like to see...
Remember, they already fought.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. I like that fight, but Jose Aldo versus Vitor Belfort.
In Brazil, right?
Yeah. In Brazil. Brazil,
yeah.
Very hard question for us to answer, you know? This gives you an example of what Joe Silva and Sean Shelby go through, because there's like over 400 fighters. I don't know how many. They have to figure out who's going to fight when and where, and now with 40, 50 shows... Trust me, there is nothing easy about being a matchmaker for the UFC. It's probably one of the hardest jobs I could imagine. And I give them both tremendous credit.
Now, one more question. Sorry.
Only one.
What's your take on TRT use in the UFC?
My take?
Both of you?
You knew you were going to get hit by that one, right? You go ahead.
I like because I have to do it. It's a medical, it's a medical prescription.
Yeah.
And, you know, if you do it the right way, you don't cheat yourself and don't cheat others. So you gotta be really professional.
Yeah, you gotta do it the right way. I am not a proponent of PEDs, no matter what. Anybody that says that marijuana is a performing enhancing drug is crazy, you know? But with that being said, the rules are the rules. And until the rules change, we need to abide by the rules. And I'm completely, completely against steroids of any kind, personally.
Thank you.
Hey, hi, young man.
Hi, Bruce and Vitor. This question is for both of you. When is UFC and you going to come to Melbourne, Australia?
First of all, man, you look so handsome. So handsome. You remind my boy. I love Australia, the fans. You know, I love surfing, and you guys had a tremendous show there in Australia.
I love surfing, too.
Yeah, so I really want to go there. Meet the people, greet the people, even fight in your country. It's beautiful.
I would say that whenever I've gone to Australia, whenever anybody asks me, out of all the cities I've been to, what do I think is one of the greatest cities in the world? I firmly believe that Sydney, Australia is one of the greatest cities I've ever been to in my life. And even when Brisbane, and I've been to Melbourne, I've had nothing but amazing experiences. Everybody's so nice, so articulate, that there's so much great restaurants, great wines, things that I enjoy, plays, surfing, which I love. You know, it just has everything there for me. And if I ever chose another place to live in the United States, I sincerely could live in Sydney, Australia. I've actually come to
Australia. Brisbane. They have one of my favorite musicians, the Hillsong. You ever heard about them? I love Hillsong. You guys know. Yeah, Relentless. I love that song.
Thank you, son.
Thank you.
Happy New Year.
Hey, no disrespect, Vitor, but I've been working so hard on this question, so this one's for Bruce Buffer. All right, Bruce, I imagine that you love your life, I really do, aside from getting your head blown off in that commercial that time. But of all the fighters that have ever fought in the UFC, including the women, which fighter would you be most likely to switch lives with?
That's a pretty interesting question, isn't it? I would have to say that just considering where he's at this point in his life and where he's gotten to at this point in his life and the fact that he has the ability to do so much good for so many people, being an ambassador of the UFC and an ambassador for his country, and what the life he's created for himself, I'm going to go with George St-Pierre.
Woo! I mean, good answer.
I wouldn't mind having some of what Vitor does when he's home, but, you know, the thing is that George, what does he do when he takes a break from a fight? He leaves the fight, he goes to the south of France. Well, that happens to be one of my favorite vacation spots. You know, I like that whole style. It's like if you ask me what actor I would like to change lives with, and I'm not enamored of actors at all, trust me, okay? They're a lot different when you meet them in person than they are on the screen, the way we expect. But I dig the style that George Clooney leads his life with. And not just because he dates so many beautiful, wonderful girls, but he's got that house in Lake Cuomo, and, you know, he does so much for charity and stuff like that. That's very similar to what I like to do.
George Clooney, St. Pierre.
George has to take me to the vacation with me. Some good wines there, no?
Okay. Why don't we go surfing? Hi. You're up, though.
Hi, Bruce. This question's for you. I just have a quick question. Just wondering if you've ever been getting friendly with a lady and accidentally broke out in your octagon voice.
He got red, no. Relax. Get a water. Get a sip of water.
I have to think very carefully how I answer this question, right? Let me just say that there have been moments of celebration. How's that?
Oh, man. I just can see you in a robe.
Oh, yeah.
I can see Bruce Buffer in a
robe.
It's time! Yeah.
That could have got me in trouble. Hi.
Hi, guys. So my name's Sandu. I'm from London, England. First of all, I'd like to wish you, both of you and everyone in the arena, a Merry Christmas and Happy New Year.
Wow. Thank you. Same to you, sir.
Thank you. My question is, a couple of weeks ago, there was a special screening of MMA filmmaker Bobby Razzak's movie, Mask, which basically looks back at the life of Charles Lewis, the founder of Tap Out. And considering both of you have been with the UFC pretty much from the beginning, I was wondering if maybe the two of you can share a story about Charles Lewis and maybe some of your encounters with him in the early days.
You know, I knew Charles and all the Tap Out guys back in the days when they were pulling their Tap Out t-shirts out of the trunk of their cars, when I was doing fights in cowboy bars, or, you know, I did many fights outside the UFC. I did almost all the MMA fights that I get my hands on. And I watched them grow to the greatness they did with their passion for what they're doing. But for me, one of the things I miss about Charles, I go into a number of different stories, but I remember when I used to announce and I would go in the red corner, because Charles and the Tap Out crew always sat like fourth row. Every time I could always hear him saying, "Give it to him, Bruce, give it to him, give it to him." And he's just standing up going crazy. And it was just one of those little of many motivating factors for me in my night of work. He was an amazing, wonderful person, and I dearly miss him.
And Vitor?
Yeah, I remember, you know, I think I'm like a T-Rex type of fighter right now. I go back in the days and I remember many things. I remember me and Bruce, we were very young. But one thing that I remember about him, he had a passion. He was drive and he never give up. And that's something that we have to take it in our heart. Don't let people define who you are, you know. You define yourself. And he did. And he became tap out, one of the biggest brand in sport. So that's what we need to learn from people is it's what drive them, what motivate them to success. And I take my hats off.
The happiest thing that Charles ever wanted in his life was to see everybody he came in contact with be happy. He was just an absolutely wonderful, warm human being.
Thank you both. Well, the film's called Mask, and apparently the filmmakers tell me it's going to be due out next year in April or May. So if you're a hardcore MMA fan or if you're a new fan, you need to go watch this movie.
Gotcha.
Bobby Razak with the commercial. I love it. And you know what? Bobby does such a great job in all his work. I highly recommend any MMA fan. If you're a fan of the sport, you need to appreciate the other people that put their work and their passion and efforts into the sport. Definitely worth seeing.
Yep. Thanks.
This question is for Vitor. Vitor, this last year, you know, the middleweight division has changed a lot, the platform. I mean, a whole bunch of new entries. You yourself, you know, with all your big victories. Do you see yourself facing any of these guys, like, you know, the Masasis, the Machidas, or Carmon, any of those guys in the near future?
UFC, man, is the future. It's the future, not just in the weight division. It's the future of sport. I think we're taking over, you know, this because of you guys. You guys supporting us so much, and the fighters giving their heart, their life, and it's for you guys, and you guys are the most important piece on the history.
You know, Vitor is touching on something very important. I think one of the beautiful reasons that why the UFC has grown so fast, and this goes all the way up to Dana White, who gives so much back to the fans, whether it's signing autographs for them in the stadium, handing out tickets, the extra efforts that he puts forth. This is a very fan-friendly organization. And the NBA, with all respect to football players, NBA players, you know, baseball, the whole bit, but it's hard to stop LeBron James walking through the hallway like you could stop Vitor and say, can I say hi or have an autograph? I'm not saying that there's an arrogance level there, but the approachability of the MMA athlete, especially the UFC, is one that gives you back what you deserve. You know, we're constantly trying to give back to you as you give so much to us. You know, because again, I'll say it again, without you guys, we're nothing. Simple. Okay? Thank you.
Thank you, guys. Obrigado, Vitor.
Thanks, man.
Hey, Bruce.
Okay.
Hi. So, okay, I've heard you speak about UFC 40, Ken Shamrock versus Tito Ortiz, and you've said that that was one of the best nights of your career. Can you just explain what was the atmosphere about that night? And also, what's Tito Ortiz's legacy in the sport? And also, can you speak about Tommy Toholt? And I'd also like to say, Dave Meltzer, you're the greatest of all time.
I love Tommy Toholt. And Dave Meltzer, I'll go with that, definitely. But also, there's Gareth. I see Gareth over there. Let's give Gareth a hand. He does a lot for us in the UK. He's definitely good, one of the best journalists over there. I can't see too far. I'd name everybody. UFC 40 was a pinnacle night for us, which happened right here. The energy in that arena with the love-hate relationship, well, the hate relationship between Ken Shamrock and Tito Ortiz, which was real, leading up to when they walked in the octagon, this place was packed. That night, the energy flowing into the octagon was so strong, and I think I say this in my book, that the card I hold in my hand, I used to hold the cards like this. Now I cut a little hole for my pinky down there because I don't know how I'm gonna move and where that card could fly. So that night, I realized I should have had that hole that night because the card was waving. There was so much energy and so much excitement coming in. It was more than we had ever had. It was just another level, right, Vitor? We've had so many different levels of fighting, you know? Just like when you win these days. Oh my gosh, everybody goes crazy.
Yeah. What's Tito's legacy in the sport?
Tito's legacy in the sport is that he was Tito Ortiz. I will tell you that Tito Ortiz is probably the best self-promoter of any fighter I've ever met and marketer. I'm not gonna get into the politics or whatever we've read about between him and the organization. My relationship with Tito is a very friendly one. We've been friends for many years. We've done a lot of things together. Tito was the champion. Tito was with us during a time period where his image was very enlightening to the brand of the sport and, you know, helped promote it. So Tito leaves his spot. You know, he achieved greatness and he can appreciate and have that as a memory for the rest of his life.
Thank you, Bruce.
Sure.
How you doing, Vitor?
What's up?
This question's for you. I'm wondering how many hours you work out a day and whether you burn out after those few last weeks.
Yeah, sometimes the less you do is better for you. Like, I'm in a stage of my life that I got the experience. So the experience is something that takes a long time to accept. But also I have new ways to work, and so you gotta see the moment. Now, for me, it's kind of different. You know, people think the more I do, the better it is. For me, sometimes the less I do is better it is. So you gotta be wise when you get 36 years old for a long time, 18 years doing this sport professionally. So you just gotta realize that I have to have something different than all these young guys.
You know, the amazing thing about Vitor, when I first met Vitor at UFC Brazil, when he knocked out Wanderlei, like just a force to be reckoned with, I immediately showed your fight to my brother Michael, saying, look at this guy, maybe he could box, you know, look at this. He was a phenom back then, and now he's had this resurgence, and he's a phenom now. I mean, this man has reinvented himself as the warrior that he is, and now he is a fierce warrior, a very fierce warrior.
Grace to God. Thank you, Chris.
Thank you.
How's it going, guys?
Hi,
my question's for you, Vitor. You consider yourself a T-Rex in the sport, and you're a big pioneer. You fought people from Tank Abbott to knocking out people like Rockhold. How have you been able to maintain such an evolution as a fighter and keep that focus and hunger to fight just evolving fighters and going through 18 years? How have you been able to stay the top at your game? Because a lot of fighters lose that hunger after they start losing to certain fighters who have been evolving. How have you been able to maintain that top level position?
Yeah, you know, in life, we have choice every day. You know, how you live your life, how you stand with your morals, and what's your standpoint of life. So I live like today's my last day of life, you know, without, you know, having my relationship with God and my relationship with my family. So that's where I end up in my work. So whatever I do, if I'm washing dishes, you know, if I'm making my bed, I'm very focused on the details of life. I'm here watching you guys. I'm trying to see the details, like the things that you guys go through in life. You know, you guys go through the same things I go. We go hardships. Sometimes we're just trying to put ourselves and trying to talk ourselves out of one way. But in the end, it's like when you accept, you know, the mistakes of your life, the things that you went through, the hardships, and then you just blend them up and make them as a fool. You know, don't feel shame. I just feel convicted that I have to do something different, and my life is not end up. So I'm so happy to be able to give to you guys just as I was at 19 years old. So I think just happy and joy and love my, this for me is like I'm in my vacation right now. I do for love, you know, I do for you guys. You guys are part of my life, my family. So thank you very much for the support. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi.
Hi, my question is for Vitor. You're widely accepted as the next contender for one of the men pictured behind you. Where would you most likely prefer to fight them, and where would you least likely prefer to fight either one of them?
You know, when you step to a jungle, you just gotta be willing to fight everywhere. That's MMA, you know. If they ask me, how you train? You prepare yourself to someone, I prepare to get better. So you expecting something comes along that you don't expect. If you're hunting a lion in the jungle, the difference between the lion is all the animals, is they're unpredictable. They're unpredictable. I'm a lion, I'm unpredictable. Get ready.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Hey guys, this is for both of you. In all the years you've been doing this, as a fan, what's the number one holy shit fight that you can bring up?
You know, there have been so many number one HS fights that I've seen. Notice how I got out of that one, huh? And again, back to what I said before, the moment we think we've seen the greatest fight, when people ask me that question, I can only name some great fights as an example. And if you want to go back to the old days, like the war this man had with Randy Couture, or Pedro, or when Randy fought Pedro Hizo, you go back to those old wars that happened back then. You look at the Gustafson-John Jones fight, the Henderson-Hua fight, you know, Jose Aldo, BJ Penn fights I can remember. There's just so many. You know, you just have to appreciate what we get to appreciate, which is greatness.
It's it's hard. It's hard to pick one. It's unjust,
right off
you
the
know.
Top of your head.
Top of my head. I love the. It's hard, man. It's just coming. So many fights on top of my head. It's so many. You know, we got BJ Penn fights. You know, amazing. I can pick up so many. I think he's one of them. You know, BJ's worse.
All right, fair enough.
Thank you.
Sorry, we couldn't give you a definitive answer, but that's the beauty of our sport.
Hi, John from Sweden.
Hello.
Question to Vitor. Which Brazilian top fighters are you normally sparring with? And second, to both of you, we have seen recently controversial decisions. Should we extend the rounds to 10 minutes like in Pride, or should we keep it 5 minutes? And second, you've seen Mark Hunt and Bader, they demolished their hands, broke the bones in their hands. Should we increase the padding in the gloves?
Why don't you address the padding in the glove answer?
Yeah, you just gotta find a way, you know, work yourself, punch. You know, sometimes you punch with big paddings, but you still break. You gotta close strong, you gotta know how to. It's hard to put a, that maybe they will be it. I'm not a professional on that point, and that, like, I think we should talk to like a doctor, or, you know, like a specialist in this area. But my specialist is not making hands, it's to punch. So I broke the hands many times. You just gotta go through it. It's part of the job.
You prefer less padding.
No, I like padding.
He likes padding. Less padding. Usually, the grappler's going to like less padding, or his wrap to be a little less tight. But you got to remember that boxing gloves were made not to protect the head; they were made to protect the hand. Okay. And when you get hit by that big, cushy boxing glove, your brain's rattling around in there. And we all know pugilistic dementia, and what, you know, people that are living from being struck on or striking their whole lives. You know what can happen to them. But people break their hands in big padded boxing gloves. So it doesn't matter, more padding. You could pad that glove with more, you're still gonna see broken hands. Mm-hmm. That's just the nature. As far as 10-minute rounds, that was great in Pride and everything, and I know we'd love to see that. I think the round system is fine the way it is. I think we just all realize what Dana White says so perfectly. Don't let the fight go to the hands of the judges. It's really that simple.
Okay. And Vitor, about those guys.
I think the heifers, they just gotta do like a... Yeah. They got to go through the training, you know. I think they need to be trained. Like Dana was telling, they need to train. They need to learn grappling, what's going on the ground. I think they need to prepare themselves just as us, you know, as a fighter. To do something, you got to be willing to learn, you know.
Okay. Which fighters, top Brazilian fighters, are you normally sparring with?
Cesar Mutant and Thiago Silva.
Never with Jacare or Silva.
Long time ago, but that's the guys that I trained today, tough guys.
Okay, thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, we have time for one more question. We've been informed, so make it a good one.
Hey, Vitor, my name is John, all the way up from your hometown of, your new hometown of Florida. So I live in Fort Lauderdale, and you're obviously right up the road, awesome. Up in Boca Raton. My father came out here with me, and he's from Holland. And my question is relative to your new camp with the Black Zillions. What is the biggest thing Henry Hooft tells you in terms of evolving your striking game, given that you are the phenom and have just obviously had amazing striking all these years?
You know, we have a great camping training, you know, Black Zillions. Henry Hooft is like a change my game as Kenny Monday, Pedro Diaz, but Henry is something else. Me and him, we have a communication. It's an eye communication. It's something that's hard to explain, you know, how fighters and trainers get along. So I can take it, and I can perform, but also we can communicate in the inside, and I think that's make the whole difference. So I'm very thankful to have a great trainers, great training partners. At Black Zenas, we have a tremendous training camp and facility, so I'm very thankful to be having this type of family around me.
Well, you have a huge support crew out in Florida, so we'll definitely be back out here again next time you're on the stage, all right?
To hello to your father.
Thank you, sir.
Take care. You guys have fun tomorrow.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, we're gonna announce the winner of the contest. Now, normally it's the best question, but we all decided in back that today it'll be the creepiest question, which was the one to Bruce Buffer about what he does when he, you know. So where's that girl? Where is she? Raise your hand. Wherever the girl
she
is.
She deserves it.
Yeah, come on down.
She took something out of him that he never did. You know?
Come on down, and I'll give you one of my business cards. So anyway, ladies and gentlemen, Vitor Belfort and Bruce
Thank
Buffer.
You guys.
Happy
Thank
holidays,
you guys.
Everybody.
Be ready.
Happy New Year. After the weigh-ins, I'll be signing books, taking pictures. If you have more questions, you can ask me over there. I'll be happy to answer them for you. Vitor, Twitter, at Vitor Belfort.
At Vitor Belfort. My Instagram is Real Vitor Belfort. I just want to thank you guys. It's amazing to be here, see you guys, and have fun. This guy's going to perform for you guys.
Enjoy, everybody.
All for
see
you guys.
You tomorrow night.
God bless you.
Thank you for coming. Love you all.